We were listening to a topic of on David, how he went to fight the Amalekites, the Philistines, praise God, and how he had lost his family, his wife, his children, and everyone, praise God. Because when David was in war, the enemy came and burned the city and took away his wife and children. And when he came back, he found none of them were there. Now, can you imagine when your wife and children have been kidnapped by the enemy and you don't even know who was the enemy and where they have been taken? Isn't that going to be a painful moment?
Yes.
And when you come, your house is all burnt. The people whom you could look for help, their houses are burned. Everybody's wife and children have been taken by the enemy. And now the enemy is going to torture them all their life. Isn't it a painful moment?
Yes.
So let's open the Bible to 1 Samuel chapter 30. And let's read verse number 8. Now, when David is in this condition, his very friends who were supposed to be with him, okay, have now planned to stone him to death. How would you feel when your own people who are supposed to be with you in times of sorrow are now blaming you for whatever has happened because their wives and children are gone and now they are so annoyed with David that they have picked up stones to kill him to death? If somebody is standing before you with weapons to kill you to death, where will your eyes be? On those people?
Weapon.
On the weapon, okay. But you will be, in your mind, will be full of
fear
of death. But do you know what David did? When they were picking up stones to stone him to death, David encouraged himself. Say that.
Amen.
Now, are you a person who encourages yourself in the Lord, or are you a person who wants to be encouraged in your spouse? Most of us, our Christian life is locked up in a spouse. If the spouse is smiling, praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus, I love you. If the spouse is not in good mood, praise the Lord Jesus, where are you? Our spouse, our life is governed by our spouse, our children, pounds, jobs, and all these things. Now here is David teaching us that when he was facing death, he learned to ignore what he saw and keep on focusing on what God had done in his life. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Are we the people who ignore some things, or are we the people who get quickly attracted to negative things?
Negative.
Hallelujah. But what was David teaching us? He ignored what was not profitable and he was only focused on things that were profitable. In our lives, what do we ignore? Our fellowship with God, and we get quickly attracted what he said, what she said, what he did not say when he was supposed to say for me, what he did not do, what he was supposed to do. Come on.
Makasanguna.
What is that, makasanguna?
Travel or go to anything, they say Makasanguna.
Then I Makasanguna.
He didn't tell me.
Oh, and that can irritate a person?
Oh, big time.
Only you, sister, not everyone.
We become reactive, most of
us. Yeah. So do we need somebody to come and encourage us? Because for us, our encouragement is to kitlo boro. Tene maga alele kuttu kuttu channu sangle. Muzo shannu le, baba, muzo shannu. bangaracho. Now all these words, people who get encouraged with these words, their life remains miserable. But that's not going to encourage you. What encourages you is the word of the living God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If your life is governed by all such kind of things, one day the person who said bhangarocho, bhangarocho, now he is saying bhangarocho. What was gold has now become scrap. Hallelujah.
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 Because our way of love is like the ECG graph. In the morning, I love you. By afternoon, it goes down. I hate you. When it is night, I love you again. It is like this. But God's love is ECG graph, straight, dead to feelings, dead to emotions, dead to your response, only alive with a decision. I love you. Do whatever you want, whether you do good or bad, it doesn't matter. I still love you. That is God's kind of love. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So David was encouraging himself in the Lord. When we start encouraging ourselves in other than God, our life is extremely unstable every day. Our life is insecure every day. But when you make God the source of your life, praise God, and encouraging yourself in the Word of God, you are unbeatable. Because everything in life changes. Your situation changes. Your place of staying changes. Your health changes. Everything changes. But there's one thing that never changes: the Word of God. And if your foundation is on the one that does not change, that foundation encourages you to stand strong and face the trials of your life, because what God has promised, He is also able to keep it and bring it to pass. Amen?
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Make a decision tonight and tell yourself, my source is not my spouse. My source is not my company. My source is not my pounds. My source is nothing. My source is God Himself.
Amen.
And when that happens, no matter who is standing against you, and you are standing with God, now you can say to yourself, when God is with me, who? Yeah, that dialogue you know. But when the match starts, at that time, do you say and believe and agree and act on it? Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody asked me, brother, you are going now for night vigil. The whole day you are standing from morning, and now you are going to stand till early morning, and then you'll go again and stand again the whole day. Brother, you must be tired. I said, no, I'm not tired. Now, is my body tired? Yes, my body is tired. Is my mind tired? Yes, my mind is tired. But He said, when I am weak, He will make me. He said, I can do all things through Christ Jesus, who empowers me, strengthens me from within. Now remember one thing. Whenever you say, the Lord is the strength of my life, He strengthens me from within. When you say these words, you feel nothing. You feel nothing. You don't feel any strength. You are not Popeye, that you eat spinach and your sleeves start tearing, the t-shirt starts tearing, and your muscles become big, and now you are going around and saying, Jesus is the strength of my life. No. Nothing of that happens. Absolutely nothing happens. But when you keep saying that Jesus is the strength of my life, I read a testimony, and that really, really affected me in my thinking. This young boy was for 19 months on the bed, dying. And everybody came, and even the pastors who came, he was not a Catholic, the pastors who came, they preached to him about heavenly life after death. So they were actually preaching him and getting him ready to go and die. Hello. And this boy was building up his faith to live. So one day he read in Mark 11, Jesus saying, verse number 24, whatsoever you pray, believe that you have received it and you shall have it. So he began to question himself and say, God, if you said, believe it, that you have received it and then you shall have it, that means if I believe I am healthy, then I should believe first that I am healthy and then I will have it. Hallelujah. So he began to think, the doctor said, I'm going to die. The pastors who came to preach me, they said, I'm going to die. Everybody is talking about my death. But God's word is only saying that I shall live. Praise God. So he decided to believe in that word and he kept on saying, thank you, Lord, that I am healed. But when he said, thank you, Lord, I am healed, his legs would not agree with him. His legs would not move. His body would not move. But he kept believing and he began to stretch his hands. He began to do something. And for the first time, after saying for a long time, his hands moved. When he saw that little movement, he was excited and he was saying, oh my God, it works. Now, did he stand on his feet? No. He just saw a little movement. And he began to do that every day. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And more movement came, but he never said to anybody anything, because whenever he said everything, anything, what had happened, they would encourage him by saying, anyway, you're going to die. See, you should not speak your faith and what is happening in your life with people of unbelief, because they are out there to kill your faith. Faith grows like a plant. It sprouts and it grows. So never speak about your faith with people who are living with unbelief. Always go and talk to people who are in faith. They will build up your faith with their faith and you will grow. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So he never told his family. And it went on. And he would put his legs down from the bed, hold the bed, and his body would not take the weight. He would fall down. He would pull with all his strength to get back onto the bed and lie down on the bed. And this is what he would do, because everybody would go to work in the morning and come back in the evening. He was always on the bed. Are you following?
Yes.
So he would not remain on the bed. He would try his best speaking the same words. And as he began to do, one day he found that he was not only out of the bed, he was standing, he was walking, and he was healed. But he did not say to anybody. One day in the morning, everybody were downstairs for breakfast. And as they were there, he came down from the stairs and sat at the table to eat breakfast. Imagine what will happen. This happened in Ireland. This man was on a wheelchair for 12 years. And he had brought his son. You can see, watch that video. The son had an allergy of celiac and he got healed. Then I told the son, can the same God heal your dad? And he said, yes, sir, he can. And we prayed and the father got out of the wheelchair and began to walk. And I asked this boy, when was the last time you saw your dad walk? He said, I've never seen him walk in my life. I said, what do you mean? He said, my dad met with an accident before I was born. So I asked him, your son has never seen? He said, no, he has never seen me standing. But today he can see me walking. I said, why don't you call up your wife and tell her that you're walking? She said, if I tell her, she might faint to death. So I said, how are you going to go home? She said, I'll have to prepare myself, because when my people see me coming home walking, many of them might faint. Because my condition was so bad that I'm not supposed to walk medically. Are you understanding?
Yes.
Because when you believe the scriptures do supernatural things in your life. Amen.
Amen.
It is only about your mind to think and imagine and believe. Amen?
Amen.
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 See, most of us seated here are saying God is going to do it. Remember this, God is not going to do anything, because what he had to do, he has done it and he has written in a document and said, from my side, I will issue the check. Now you deposit and get the amount transferred.
Yes.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
as I have got this wire, inside this is metal, and from the metal flows the power, but on the outside there is a rubber or a plastic, which is an insulation. The power doesn't flow. Our unbelief is what blocks God's power. God's power is all the time flowing through His word.
Amen.
It is our unbelief. What about you, young man? How are you? Can you just stand up? And can you just walk? Oh, you are going looking for your crutches?
No.
Show me how you are walking. Isn't he the same man who got healed last time?
Yes.
Where are you? Come here, come here. Isn't he the same man?
Yes.
How many years you were not walking?
I was walking, but...
With the crutches?
Yeah.
And with pain?
Yes.
For how many years?
8 years, just 6 weeks.
Only 6 weeks?
Before the operation.
The last time you said in 2000...
That was when I fell down. It.
Okay.
Was giving a pain.
And now you're walking?
Yeah.
Now you're happy?
Yes.
Yes.
Looks younger.
He not only looks younger. From where have you come? From Swindon?
I'm Swindon.
Ah. Praise God. Isn't he looking handsome now?
Yeah.
Praise God. God bless you.
No. Wife is not there. Wife is there?
No.
Wife also got healed, no, that day?
Yes.
So she stayed at home, huh?
No, she has to go to work. That's
she has to go to work. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah, thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Thank Praise you. God. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, you.
It doesn't sound like what you just said, that he was unable to.
And let me tell you, I've never met him before. Others, you will say they were both were planned before. Did I know you?
No.
No, good. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So this boy, he got healed, and then he wanted to help his family. Okay, so he said, "I want to get a job." So he goes out to work. Imagine for 19 months on the bed, he has got only bones. And doctor said, last stage. And he is now going for a job. Now, if you are a manager and somebody like that comes to ask for a job, and what job? Manual job. Will you give him a job?
No.
You will say, if I give you a job, I'll have to have another job. Who is going to put you in the coffin? Come on.
Yeah.
Now he went for a job, and the man at the position said, I don't think so you can work. He said, give me a chance at least. I'll show you how I can work. And he said, okay, there are those people out there pulling the weeds out. Go and work over there. So when he went to pull, praise God, all the others who were working, they started laughing. Because his body and the work was a big mismatch. So he went with all his strength, he pulled out one small plant. And by that time, in one plant, he was tired. So he began to say, God, if I believed of my healing and your power healed my body, I'm believing the same way that you are the strength of my life.
Amen.
Okay? And he began to say, Jesus, you are the strength of my life. And he said, when I said these words, I did not feel anything. I could not even feel any strength that come. But because I believed, I went to the next plant. Because I believed, I went to the next plant. And when I began to pull with all my strength, and I could not, I began to thank God that He is the strength of my life. The moment I thank God, believing according to Mark 11:24, whatsoever when you desire, whatsoever when you pray, whatsoever you desire, believe that you have
received
it, and then you shall have it.
Amen.
So when he believed that, and he began to pull, the trees down out of the ground. And as he began to do, by evening he had done a great job. Okay, And all were laughing and they were saying, tomorrow you won't be there. And the next day he was there. And this continued. After 2 weeks he found everybody had fallen out. He was the only one on the job because he did not rely on his strength but God's strength.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do you understand that?
Yes.
And that's what Jesus, that's what David was doing. He was encouraging himself in the Lord. How do you encourage yourself in the Lord? There's one more man who was extremely discouraged and he was in depression. Who is that man? His name is Joshua. Joshua, the mighty deliverer, who could bring the Jericho wall down, who could take the Israelites to the promised land and give them their shares. The same Joshua, when he started his journey with God, he was in depression. Why was he in depression? Because his friend Moses had just died and he would be the succeeding leader. And what kind of congregation did he have? He had the world champions in what? Grumbling, murmuring and complaining. If you got people around you who are champions in these three things, you are very encouraged to go and do the job. Is it right? Come on. It's very discouraging. And second, he has to take them to the promised land and there he's going to face the giants and the other enemies. And his congregation are those people who have never ever seen a battle in their life. They are all these youngsters who were born in the desert in the last 40 years. They have never done any war or fight. If you got soldiers in your team who never knew how to hold a weapon and you're going to take them for a war, what do you think will be? Is it encouraging or discouraging? And do you know what God said? Joshua, do not be discouraged. In other words, God is giving Joshua, how can you come out of your stress? How can you come out of your depression? How can you come out of your fear? He gives three things. First thing, Joshua 1 verse 8, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. In other words, every time you open your mouth and you speak God's word. That means from now on, you are not going to speak the problems that you see. But when you see the problems, you are going to speak my promises. So what is Joshua being trained? He is trained to master his tongue. First point, master your tongue. Touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, master your tongue. Stop talking about your problems. Tell your neighbor. Tell your neighbor. Stop talking about your master your master your master your. Now, how many of us fail in this category? Only one person. Do we fail in this category of mastering our tongue?
Yes.
Or we are world champions in talking about our problems?
Yes.
See, listen, when we are opening our mouth and speaking what we fear, we already believe that those things that are coming against us are more powerful than God. That's why we are speaking our fears. And God said to Joshua, first thing, stop that. Second thing, when you have mastered your tongue, now master your mind. God said to Joshua, meditate on the word day and night. Meditate on the word
day and night.
Think on the word of God day and night. If you think on the word day and night and the Bible day and night, John Melta, Pound Melta, huh? Bible karte hai, John Melta re. Have you heard this dialogue?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
But is God saying that?
No.
Huh?
Yes, man does not live on bread alone.
No. On this scripture, meditate on the word day and night.
Yes.
Is God saying that? Yes. Let me show you. Any of the lady, have you ever got worried?
Yes.
At least once in your lifetime?
Yes.
Good, good. Can I ask any lady who has got worried Okay, well, you are always ready. You are an honest lady. Praise God. Anytime saying, yes, brother, I am worried. Look at others, nobody raising their hand. Can I get one volunteer? Okay, the sister in red. You said you got worried at least once in your lifetime. Okay, let's say you are worried. Can you come here? Oh my God. She already got worried. I only wanted to check whether she's getting worried. This side. How many of you heard her say, oh my God? So, you see, just getting her from there to come here, she's already worried. Okay. Now, you said you were worried. You got worried. Let's say you were cooking some good dish and you got worried. Question number one. Do you switch off the gas and sit down and finish your worry? And then after you finish your worry, then you put on the gas and cook? Two, you worry and at the same time cook?
The same time.
Which one? First one or second one?
First one.
First one. So you switch off the gas and you sit down.
Yeah.
And you don't cook.
No, I'm cooking.
No, you are confusing me now. I'm worried. No, you understood what? Step one point.
Yeah.
When you are worried, you stop the gas, you stop all your activities, you sit down there and you keep on worrying. When your worrying is over, then you come back, switch on the gas and you start cooking.
Yes.
Point number one. Point number two is you worry and cook at the same time.
Which one you want?
Now she's worried which one to say. Acha, Konkani.
No, I know English.
Okay, so which one?
It's the second one.
Right? Second one. So you mean to say you can worry and cook at the same time? Wow! She can worry and cook at the same time, can you believe that?
Yes.
And the curry with the oven.
You can worry and cook at the same time?
Yes.
Is it possible practically?
No.
Yes.
There are so many who are not only worried, they also cry, and then instead of putting salt,
hallelujah.
And when the husband comes, he says, the curry is very different today. Okay. Now, if a person worries and cooks at the same time, which is possible, isn't it possible for a person to meditate on the word and cook at the same time?
Yes.
But do we do that?
No.
Because when it comes to meditating of the word, we want to switch off everything and sit down. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God says the real relationship with God is not when you cut off everything and sit down. The real relationship with God is when everything is going on in your life, you are still connected to Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Has anybody ever tried to connect Wi-Fi?
Yes.
You don't have internet connection and you went to somebody's house and you really need the internet connection. Are you going to say, can I get the Wi-Fi?
Password.
Now you got the password. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now that you are connected, can you do all the things?
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Now when you are working something else, at the same time, can you do the Wi-Fi connection at the same time?
Yes.
Three, four things at the same time and Wi-Fi?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Now in the same way, can we have Wi-Fi connection with God?
Yes.
And do all things at the same time with connection with God?
Yes.
But do we do that?
No.
Yes.
Clearly.
Yes.
Under pressure?
No.
Now, my sister was leading us into praise. She was singing songs of praise. When the real trouble starts and it's painful, does she put on that and starts praising? At that time, do we sing songs of praise?
No.
Oh. Under pressure, what comes out? Okay, let me ask you. You got worried, I understand. Have you ever got angry?
Yes, sometimes.
You get angry? It doesn't show that you can ever get angry. You look so sweet. Can you believe this lady gets angry? Any lady has ever got angry? We men, our fuse is all the time like a cooker. Praise God. But a woman gets angry?
Yes.
Look at Juliet, what she's saying. I never get angry. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When you get angry, what words come out? What you are thinking that triggered you to get anger, that same thing is coming out of your mouth. Because what you are meditating in your mind decides whether you get worried, angry, offended, bitter, revengeful. It's all about is khobri ke karkhane mein kya chal raha hai, usi ke anusar bahar nikalta hai. Production bahar nikalta hai. Machine chalta hai, production bahar nikalta hai. Hallelujah. Machine chalta hai na? Exhaust. Praise God, thank you. Deo Paolo. Hallelujah. She'll say, never again will I ever lift my hand again. So first thing, master your tongue. Second thing, master your mind. If a person is able to do these two things by default, he will be able to master his action. If these two things are not strong, the person will try to master his action with his willpower, but willpower will always get him into frustration. But if he is mastering his mouth, mastering his mind, now the power of God will help him to master his action. And only those who are able to master their action, God says, they are the ones who will be able to, to make their way first prosperous and make their way successful. So your prosperity and success does not depend on God, does not depend on the devil. It depends on you. Did Joseph become prosperous? Did he get the big position?
Yes.
But when everything came against him, was he still meditating on the promise of God?
Yes.
Did he react?
No.
Was he still walking in love?
Yes.
Was he still walking in forgiveness?
Yes.
Did the favor of God take him to the highest position?
Yes.
Now when somebody hurts you, do you still walk in love? Yes. No. Do you get offended? Never. Are you ready to forgive all the time? And that's why my position is going to rise higher. Listen, my friend, how many of you believe with promotion comes more responsibility?
Yes.
But yet we are always praying, God, give me promotion.
Yes.
Because we love responsibility. Is it that we love responsibility or we love more pounds? Let's be honest. Why do you want to be promoted?
Because of extra money.
There's one man who is talking honest. What, brother?
Because of extra money.
But you ask others, they will say, I want promotion because I want to work more. I want to take more responsibility. That's why I'm all the time praying. And when somebody else gets promoted and I don't get promoted, I'm angry. Why? Because that person is able to work more than me. Is that the reason? Hello?
Yes.
Why do you want promotion?
By extra money.
Not only extra money, with that comes extra packages.
Position.
Pride. Then comes car. All those terms come. Based on what? On the promotion. Praise God. So God says, if you don't start, hey, praise God. Anybody from India?
Yes.
No, no, not all. They are from Ireland. Okay. Now, in India, do we parents tell our children, study? And the mother, children, what mom, study. And when the child gets 85 or 85, the mom says, what about the 15?
100%.
Yeah. If the child has to ask the mama, what percentage did you get? Mama will faint. Thank God our children don't know the truth. Is it right?
Yes.
The children got, say, 80% in 10, standard 10. What, only 80%? What did she get? What did he get? Then the child should say, Mama, how much did you get? Okay. Now, why is the mama so much forcing on study? Because if you don't pass the test, you cannot be promoted to the next level, right?
Yes.
Now, do we do the same when it comes to our spiritual life? We are saying, God, bless me. He said, pass the test. Lord, let the preacher pass the test and lay his hands on me and I get promoted. Hello? Promotion in life, in our spiritual life, in God's plan and purpose, comes through passing the test. And many people think, I got qualified because every day I go to church. Every day I pray to God. Every day I read my Bible. Every day I say all my novenas and my rosary and all those prayers, brother. Every day I do that. So also a child every day studies, but on the day of exam write all wrong answers. Will the teacher promote the child to the next class?
No.
So why should you pray every day? You pray every day so that every day you are strengthened to build up your mind to write the right answers. So many people think, you know, from the last 10 years, how I am in this prayer group for the last 10 years. And this person comes for the last 6 months. And he gets so much blessed. And I'm here for 10 years, nothing's happening. Do you know why? Because the one who is coming for the last 6 months is passing the test. And you are there for 10 years, having big batches, but never passing the test. Will you get promoted?
No.
If you want to ruin somebody's life, give him a big batch. Have you ever seen any volunteer getting a batch? And that batch should be colorful and it should be big. From a distance everybody can see. Once the batch comes, what happens to his chest? What happens to his words? Does he pass the test of love?
No.
Or does he pass the test of pride?
Pride.
Now such a person can get promoted in the kingdom of God?
No.
Never. So your title is only on this planet earth, but your love activates the power in heaven.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You are with Wi-Fi with God when you are walking in love. Is that clear?
Yes.
So what was David doing now? His friends have got stones in their hand to kill him. But what is David doing? David is encouraging himself in the Lord and focusing on the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
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 How true the word of God is. The last shall be first.
The first shall be last.
The first shall be last.
I did not say, he said. Superb, yaar. You come last and you take the first seat.
Praise the Lord.
The Bible is so true. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So, did David encourage himself with the Lord? I want somebody to read the verse number 8. Look at what God, what David is asking God. 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 8. 30, 30, 30. David inquired of the Lord,
shall I pursue these raiders?
Okay, can I go after them then?
Can I overtake them?
Will I catch them?
The Lord answered him.
Go and pursue.
For you shall surely overtake them. And effect a rescue.
And you will surely
rescue them.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now did David ask God, should I pursue? Did God said pursue?
Yes.
Now in our life, when somebody has got some sickness or some problem, do we pursue to overcome it? Or do we say, God, you do it? Are we active or passive? Active to fight or passive to relax? Really? So the next time the sickness comes anywhere close, you are active to fight.
Yes.
And let me ask you, how do you fight?
With the word of God.
You take a hammer and start hitting your leg. Hallelujah. So God is saying, whatever your situation is now, the enemy is trying to gain ground in your mind and have control over your mind, so that the enemy wants your mind to turn from victor to victim. When a person's mind has turned into a victim, he has got no courage to fight back. He gives up. He says it's hopeless to fight. I accept defeat, and accepts that sickness in his life, or accept that trouble in his life, and says, this is how I'm supposed to live, so let me live a life with this trouble. But what about David? What did he ask? Lord, should I pursue? And the Lord said, yes, pursue. And you will not only overcome it, overtake it, you will also in this pursue able to rescue your wife and children and bring them back. Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So I've got a few points with me, how to pursue. So you can write down the point and then we will study. We'll study one point at a time. Praise God. The first point is how to pursue the promises of God. How to pursue? Hello, how to pursue? How to pursue? So what is very important? First thing, I must search for promises. So the first one is locate the promise. Locate the promise. You need locate the promise you need from the Word of God. Locate the promise you need from the Word of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can somebody read Mark chapter 4 verse 14? See, before you get your miracle, the first step to fight back is locate the promise you need for your situation or for the battle from the word of God. Mark 4:14, Bill.
The sower sows the word.
The sower
sows the word.
God's message. Yeah, the sower sows God's message.
Oh, the word, the word.
Yeah, the word.
Now, has anybody ever sown any seed? In the garden, today I went to one particular garden and I saw a very small apple tree. And this tree was full of apples. I never knew such a small tree can give so many apples. I saw tomatoes and the tomatoes were like a garland, all hanging so many. And I was so impressed with that. Praise God. Did she pray to God for an apple tree and a tomato plant, or did she actually plant the seed? What if she keeps the ground all fertile and everything and keeps on praying, God, one apple tree.
No.
God, I want apples. Give me apples, Lord. What will he say? Plant the plant from the nursery.
Sow the
or sow the seed. Or which seed?
Apple seed.
Apple seed. So when you sow an apple seed, what do you get?
Apple
tree. Praise God. And when does the tree bear fruit? No, only when the tree matures. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In the same way, when will you get the fruit of the word of God?
Word.
When you mature with your patience. In Christian life, your maturity is never judged based on how much you know the Bible. Your maturity is never judged on how much you preach. Your maturity is never judged on how much good you do in the church. Your maturity is judged how much under pressure you can still be patient. Was Jesus extremely patient when he was falsely judged and condemned to death? Even when he had the power to retaliate and kill all those soldiers, did he still allow them to torture him, hurt him, and beat him up?
Yes.
Was he full of patience?
Yes.
Even unto the death?
Yes.
And that's called as a matured Christian, a matured person. Praise God.
Praise
now, what about the apostles? Were they all the time fighting before Jesus' death? Yes. They were fighting for position? Yes. They were fighting for power? Yes. But after Jesus' death and resurrection and receiving the Holy Spirit, do you find them fighting for all those things?
No.
What about us? Do we fight for position in the prayer group? Never. Praise God. Hallelujah. Do we fight for any other things? Never. Praise God. Because we are filled with the Holy Spirit. Pavitra Atma, Yetu Jau Jan. Correct? And when that ouzo comes, then what happens to our ouzo?
Heart is molded.
Huh?
Heart broke. By the words, bad words comes out.
In the prayer group also comes?
Yes.
Because our focus is on me. As long as I am supposed to be blessed, as long as I am supposed to be benefited, as long my image of I is alive, I will always have hurt. The moment I is dead, and now the person is not interested in building his kingdom, his life, but the kingdom of God and others, he is never hurt. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And praise God, in our prayer groups, we always think about the kingdom of God. And our focus is always on others. How can I be a blessing for others? Praise God. And when that happens, the prayer group cannot remain small. It will always multiply. Because now, when a person is coming for the service, he is not interested in himself. He is interested in somebody who is in trouble to pick him up take him for the service and drop him back. I can tell you, when I started understanding the word of God, I began to realize, when I go once a week to the prayer group, I used to call, that's my petrol gas station. I fill the petrol for that day, and for the whole week I use the petrol. Means, what was taught, I practice it for the whole week. And when I'm coming for the next week, I'm seeing to it that I catch hold of two or three on the way and bring them to the gas station. I would never come for the service alone, never. In a week, I would catch somebody or the other and bring them to the gas station. And when I began to do that, I did not realize that's how it should be. I did not realize the Holy Spirit put it in my heart. And what started of getting the people? I remember one day I took about 15 people. Okay, 45 kilometers. I borrowed somebody's car and took two, three cars. Okay, put them in and reached there. And when in those days, you know, when you bring a big number of people, your chest also is out. Hello? I'm talking to you my experience. And my chest was out. And Father used to be there after the mass sitting for counseling. And I would say, sit down here. And I would go and sit with somebody and I would boast, I brought 15. And there was this man who had a telephone ministry. I'll never forget. He had a telephone ministry. He looked at me and he said, can you see that lady? She had the badge. Okay. I said, yeah, I can see her. He said, if you can keep your eyes fixed on her for the next 15 minutes, I guarantee you, you will faint. And he was on a telephone ministry. What was his ministry? When anybody calls for any prayer, he would pray. So I said, okay, and I kept my eyes on her, looking what she's doing. Now, supposing all of you are sitting in a row, and in number wise. So next one is your turn. When will be your turn? After her. Then will be after her. Now what will she do? She'll pick her up and put her here, and she'll put somebody there. So it has become now all shuffling. And when all these things happen, she's saying, hey, listen, I was there, I'm supposed to go. So she creates confusion. Because she wanted, when there's confusion, she can say, I remember you were here and then. Are you following?
Yes.
She wanted some activity.
Yes.
If there is no activity, she has got no job. Are you understanding?
Yes.
And this man was saying, this is every time, twice a week. And it will go on till 12 o'clock in the afternoon. It started at 9 o'clock. Till 12 o'clock, I'm going to face this. And I went and told Father, Father, why don't you take her out? She's really creating confusion. Father said, you don't look at her, what she's doing. You pray for her. So he began to pray and said, God, please transfer her. Do something and keep her home. Let her not come. And you know what God said? He said, I put her there for you. Lord, you put her there for me? And he said, do you know from the last 2 days, God is saying, this lady is working here for me. I said, what do you mean? He said, I am a person who cannot tolerate all these things. If Father was not there, I would have thrown her out of the lane she could not cross. I am a very impatient man. This lady, from the last 2 days, when I renewed my mind, is teaching me extreme patience.
Wow.
Do we have such kind of people in your life?
Yes.
Why do
you... But it's not him.
Ah, thank God. That's your husband.
My husband.
Yeah, yeah. Not same. No, because I was thinking...
Patience
is okay, praise God. So, why do you think such irritating people are in your life? And what are we praying? Father God, you know how much he's troubling me. Please, Lord, transfer him from this job. Put him in some other department or let him lose his job. And if that is not happening, Lord, kill him, do something, but let him get him out of my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when he said this, then he looked at me and I told him, brother, this time I brought 15 people. And he looked at me and he said, I really feel sorry for you. I really feel
sorry for you.
I thought he's jealous. That's why he's saying, I really feel sorry for you. And I said, why do you say that you feel sorry for me? Are you not happy that I brought so many people over here? He said, I'm feeling sorry for you because I'm wondering, how many years are you going to bring these people over here? So I said, what do you mean? He said, brother, which one will be better? That you come here, learn how to do fishing, and don't bring those people here for fish. Why don't you give them the fish where you are? Why don't you learn fishing? What father is doing, the job inside. Why don't you learn the same job? Then you don't have to bring them 45 kilometers. You can teach them fishing over there. I said, does it work? He said, if you make that a goal, it will surely work. And I will never forget this man who changed my attitude. And from that on, that day on, I said, Lord, I want to be fisher of men. So you are going to teach me how to fish. But I promise you that what you teach, I'll go around teaching others. And that's how God made me fishers of men. But God saw my heart. And what was my heart? To bring this loss to the fold. Hallelujah.
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 So, very important is, I must have a heart to reach out. So what's the first thing you wrote, first point? If you got a problem, remember, you must search for the promise of God that gives you solution to your problem. So let me give you one promise that can always make you rejoicing. Supposing you are working in an office and there is somebody who keeps on irritating you, insulting you, and even talking to the higher authorities against you falsely. I know this doesn't happen in London, but it's very common. Look at the way you responded. When other things I'm talking, they don't respond, but this one. So quick. Okay, now. Let's say if it is happening. Option number one, you can't retaliate. So you can go to the bathroom, shut the door and curse that person. No. Option number two, you can show that you are off mood. Option number three, you can take all those words and like the England cow after eating grass sits under a tree and keeps on chewing what she ate, in the same way you can sit in one corner and keep chewing what he did to you. Now, will these options that you took help you in any way?
No.
Will it give you a great future?
No.
Praise God. Now, what will you do when somebody did such things and you lost your job? In relationship, somebody is instigating your spouse and making you do things against you and torture you, what will be your response? On one side is the husband's mother. She wants a boy. On the other side, wife is saying, I did not get married to a boy. I got married to a husband. Give me back my husband. And she's saying, give me back my boy. Poor husband. What does he do? He wants to be the mother's boy. At the same time, he wants the wife's husband. Can there be a torture?
Yes.
Yes.
What do you do?
Patient. Give mother-in-law sleeping tablets.
Brother? Brother?
I told you I have tolerance.
How many years married, brother, now?
Oh, silver jubilee.
And still strong?
Yeah.
and all the hair still intact?
It's going.
Come on, she was just joking. What do you do?
Pray.
Okay, I'll show you something that will make you all excited. Praise God. Are you ready?
Yes.
So the next time you will be praying, God, let's send somebody to trouble me. I can tell you without a doubt, if my rewards and my blessings have come into my life, it's only because of the troubles that I went through unjustly. Write it, first of all, write in bold capital letters, every false accusation. Write it in capital letters so that you never forget all your life. Every false accusation is the last stage. Is the last stage before supernatural promotion. Do you like that?
Yes.
Before supernatural what? That you did not forget, that you heard correctly. The promotion word you can hear clearly. Okay. Praise God. Now, let's study this line. I've got not much time because we have got so many points, so we'll go fast. Now, in Joseph's father's house, did his brothers love him?
No.
Now, did he do anything wrong?
No.
But did the brothers hate him?
Yes.
Was that unjust?
Yes.
Now, did Joseph react to it? He was all the time focused on the dream that God had given him. Now, did that action of the brothers help Joseph in the future?
Yes.
How?
He was focused on God.
So when they sold him as a slave, did God allow Joseph to go through unjust situations that he got practice at home, that when he was sold as a slave, was he ready to be alone? Well, in his father's house, the gang was on one side. Was he alone?
Yes.
But even though he was alone, was he lonely?
No.
Why not? Because his mind was full of God. Is it possible for a person who is alone to be lonely? A person who is all alone at home, can he be lonely?
Yes.
Yes. Can a person have a big family and still be lonely?
Yes.
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 Are you understanding?
Yes.
So even though Joseph was alone, he was not even lonely. And that's why he was trained to keep his focus on God. Amen?
Amen.
So remember, your bad experience does not go wasted. It is God preparing you for a big future and you must pass the test. Now, did Joseph pass the test?
Yes.
Now, did he get promoted or did he get sold as a slave? Oh, yeah. To be sold from his father's house to a slave is promotion. So let me pray for your promotion now. Hello? Is that called a promotion? It looks like a total disaster. But was Joseph worried about what happened? No. Because he was full of God, he kept saying to himself, God, I don't understand why this happened, but I do believe you have given me that dream and this is a part of the dream. I am work in progress. Praise God. Now, because of his right mindset, did Joseph perform well in his work? Yes. Did God bless him?
Yes.
Why did God bless him? Because he was walking in love or because he was walking in bitterness? A person, even when people have done wrong to him and he walks in love and forgiveness, that person cannot be defeated. I repeat again. A person who goes through unjust suffering and people falsely accuse and do all kinds of negative things to him, but he responds with love and forgiveness, he cannot be stopped. God will still exalt him. And a person who quickly gets offended and bitter, even if he's in a big position, that will bring him down. So people who are saying, brother, you know, I get offended quickly, I get bitter quickly, I get angry quickly, I get hurt also quickly. You know, if that is your attitude, you can never be promoted in the kingdom of God. Your life will be miserable till your last breath. That's why people will keep on cursing. You know, brother, my life is messed up because of whom? Because of this fellow. From the day I got married, I was so happy in my father's house. I just got married, my God. I got married to the boy, the whole package came along with him. And the mama is not ready to leave the boy. And because of this, the wife is irritated and offended. Will she ever get any peace and promotion in her life? Never. But the same lady takes the case of Joseph and says, God, you have put me in this family because I'm the one who is supposed to carry the gospel of light and bring salvation to this family. I'm ready to take this assignment, Lord, and you're going to help me. Now, has the attitude changed? Hello, has the attitude changed?
Yes.
And when that unjust suffering was done, and she does not retaliate, but allows the person to hurt her. Now, did Jesus say, when somebody slaps you on one cheek, give the other one?
Yes.
Why did he say that? Hey, why did he say that? And when Jesus was before Pilate, and Jesus said, and one of the soldiers, high priest servant, slapped him. Did Jesus turn the other cheek or did he say, why do you strike me? He never turned the other cheek. He said, why do you strike me? But for us, he says, when somebody strikes you on one cheek, give them the other. But what about Jesus? Did he turn the other cheek or did he ask, why do you strike me? So for us, different. For him, different. Hello? Then isn't it written in the Bible? Hey, come on, let's read the passage. Come on. Isn't it there in the Bible?
Yes.
He said, when somebody slaps you on one cheek, turn the other one.
Yes.
But when Jesus was on trial and one of the servants struck him, he said, why do you strike me? Why did he do that? Why he did not turn the other cheek? When Jesus says turn the other cheek, does not mean turn the other cheek like listen. When somebody strike me on one cheek, and I will say, hey, listen, you strike me now. Jesus said, give the other cheek. Come on, come on. Hey, strike me. Hey, what are you looking? Strike me. Come, you want my phone? Come on, give me. Does that mean? Now listen. Supposing I and Juliet had enmity, okay? And Juliet went for a retreat, and in that retreat she learned that you must walk in love and forgiveness. So she made up her mind, I will go and reconcile, okay? And there was a birthday party, and she knows in this birthday party I will be invited, and she was also invited, common friend. So she knows that I will be there. So she's preparing herself. I will go and talk to this man. Listen, I am extremely sorry. I think so. It was my mistake. I want to reconcile. Come on. And that's all. She has prepared herself at home. And she comes for the party. Now I'm sitting with my friends on this side. And she walks and she puts her hand out and she says, listen, whatever has happened, I'm sorry and all that. And I turn and give a tadak. Now when she gets that slap on a cheek in front of everybody, what will she do?
Angry.
Angry or full of shame. She'll walk out.
Bitterness.
She'll have bitterness and all that. Now did that slap change her decision to forgive? Come on.
Yes.
You know what Jesus is saying? The decision that you made to love and forgive, let the second slap also not change your decision. He's talking about not slap, he's talking about your attitude. And that's why when they strike Jesus on his cheek, his attitude to love and forgive was the same. Are you understanding?
Yes.
Did you get that?
Yes.
Praise God. When somebody slaps you and put you to shame, is that attitude going to change? Is your feelings going to change?